It's showtime.
The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Very, very special song and video today.
This song says, no matter who you are, no matter where you go in your life, at some point you're gonna need somebody to stand by you. Oh yeah, oh my darling, stand by me. No matter who you are, no matter where you go in life, you gon' need somebody to stand by you. No matter how much money you got, all the friends you got, you gon' need somebody to stand by you.
When the night has come and the land is dark, and that moon is the only light we see, though I won't be afraid, though I won't, she won't care just as long as the people come and stand by me.
Venezuela, Congo, South Africa, Spain, South Africa, California, New Orleans, Italy, South Africa, pressure.
Not as long as you, yeah.
Good morning, everybody. This is Dr. Minarsik, and even though we just took a trip around the world, I'm kind of hanging out in Chicago still for a while. And today is Thursday, October 27th, and this will be our 12th two-hour global medical school pathology session in which we will discuss the second half of Robin's seventh chapter of general pathology called neoplasia. Good morning. I guess the first thing I should do is to ask you a couple of little questions here, because it's very important for me to know. Number one, did you hear the music pretty well? Good. Now, I know I was playing a video on my end, and you may not have seen it as smoothly as I did because of the bandwidth differences, but were you able to see some clips of the video, even if it was slow, from various countries? Okay, I'm hearing no from some and yes from others. I'm not surprised, because if you have a slow bandwidth, you may not see the video very well or even at all. Some people probably saw it a little bit. That was one of the most spectacular songs I've ever seen. It's called Stand By Me, and it was basically performed by musicians all over the world simultaneously due to the miracle of the internet, just like this class. I kind of like that song because I think it's a lot like my class. I basically am here, but you're all over the world, and it is just a spectacular thing what we could do these days. Okay, that was the only thought that I had for this morning, so now we'll be discussing the second half of Chapter 7, Neoplasia. Just a couple of words of introduction about it. You know, last session we had 5 days ago, oh, I'm sorry, 2 days ago, was really intense fun for me. It was basically every pathologist's dream, because it's basically an explanation of what they do their whole life and how they see things. And it was extremely graphic, and for me it was really fun as well. Today's discussion on neoplasia is not going to be exactly what I would call as much rock and roll fun. It's going to be very, very intense. There's going to be a lot of data. Unfortunately, there will probably be, for many of you, a lot of intense things, new things to learn as well. Especially if you had not had a strong background in cell biology or genetics. And it's going to be a little bit more intense, but for me it's going to be fun as well, because today we will take about 2 hours to answer the simple question, something you've wondered about your whole life and something maybe you expected to see during this class, is the answer to the question, what causes cancer? So today we'll finish the chapter on neoplasia, going much, much into the causes as well. Last year we took 4 days, or 4 2-hour sessions, to deal with the entire chapter. The first 2 days were basically lectures or discussions from Robbins, summarizations, and the last of the 4 days were strictly labs. It's going to be a really, really large lab. If you looked in Rock Lab, which I'm sure you have at one point or not, you saw that there's gazillions of cases on tumors. And even though these will be repeated in some of the other chapters we'll be discussing, I'll probably do maybe 40, 50 cases of the prime things that are worth repeating. So we're going to have 2 full laboratory-only sessions on cancer, and that's going to be next week. It's going to be Tuesday and Thursday of next week. Next week I will also be in Washington, D.C., visiting my son and doing trick-or-treating with my grandbabies. So will be broadcasting from his place in Virginia. And as although I was not happy with my trip to Vegas in terms of bandwidth, I have already been to his house many times, and he has spectacular bandwidth. It's 10 times bigger than mine. He has a service out there called Cox, which is so much better than anything we have here in the Midwest. Okay, I think that's all that I wanted to say. What we're going to be doing today is answering the question in 2 hours, what causes cancer? I guess I could do that in 2 seconds, so, or maybe 5 seconds. So let's see if I could summarize the whole thing. If you have people in your family that have cancer, or if you had it yourself, or you know somebody that died of it or is dying, of course the question always is why, how did it happen, how did it start? And there's all kinds of theories, from evil spirits to genetic mutations. What causes cancer, before I go into all the details, are mutations in the cells which normally regulate cell growth. So if you have mutations in those genes of cells that regulate growth, you're going to have unlimited growth, and that's what cancer is. So I think that's the best way I could say it. Let's go into it in a little bit more scientific detail now, and this little PowerPoint will look familiar with you because we finished about half of it. I think we did like about 40 slides out of 90 or so. So we're going to do the second half today. I guess a good question to ask at this time in my little question box is, is everybody able to see the screen in front of you very well? Do you see what it says in big letters? Okay, good. Everybody's saying yes. And did anybody see a little animal on the screen before I opened up the PowerPoint? Okay, so everybody's seeing well and hearing well. And I know you like the music, so let's get into the second part of this chapter here. We're going to zip down to about 40, which is where I think we left off. And we went into this discussion in pretty good detail, and we talked about a linear difference, very solid differences between benign and malignant tumors, with, of course, invasion being the single most absolute dividing line between benign and malignant tumors. A few things about statistics and epidemiology, at least in the United States, which is where I'm broadcasting from. People always want to know, well, what are the most likely cancers that people get? Well, if you're in the United States and you're a man, the most likely cancer you'll get, the one with the highest incident for males, is also something that is specific for a male, and that's prostate cancer. And as you can see, it kicks ass out of all the other ones. It's more than twice of whatever's in second place. So it's a big number one. Now, likewise, if you're a woman, and that's pink rather than blue, the most likely cancer that you'll get is also specific for your sex, and that's breast cancer. And as you can see, it kicks butt out of everything else, also more than twice of what it adds up to about all the others put together, just like prostate adds up to all the others put together. But look, number two is something that is not sex specific. It's lung cancers. And number three is also not sex specific. It's colon and rectum cancers. Now here's an interesting thing. Although prostate is the biggest incident for males, it's only number two for mortality. And same thing with a woman. Even though breast is number one for women, it's number two in mortality. So even though the number one most common cancers are sex specific, the number one killer is in second place for incidence, and that's lung and bronchus. That's because lung cancers are a lot more lethal than prostate or breast cancers. That's the conclusion you could make. Here's another little graph showing, at least in the United States, over the last, 35 years, the incidences of various cancer. You can see lung and bronchus has actually gone down a bit for males, And it's actually come up a little bit for females. The breast has gone up somewhat. Prostate has gone up significantly. Took a little blip somewhere about 20 years ago, and it is still rising, but not as fastly as it was before. I don't know. I guess we can make some conclusions for that blip, but it's not important. What the important thing is that for men, prostate is the biggie, and for women, breast is the biggie. But the biggest killer, look, it's in second place in terms of incidence. And with women, the biggest killer a while back was number 4 in incidence, and now it's number 2. Let's look at another interesting things in terms of sex differences. Here is the cancer rates for females. I should probably show the male one first, and I'm not being chauvinistic here. Here's the cancer rates for males in the United States, and notice that lung and bronchus started to go up right after World War II, when they start giving all those GIs free cigarettes, and they sold them in the VA hospitals. And now, look at this. It's the biggest killer by far. And even though it's come down, let's say, in the last 20 or 30 years, it's still by far the biggest killer. Now look, the thing to remember, though, is it started going up about in the mid-40s, maybe late 40s, post-World War II. Let's look at women now. We know that for death rates, it's the biggest in women, too. But it started going up in the mid-60s rather than the mid-40s. So that means something that you could very easily conclude is that the massive smoking with women started about, oh, maybe 20 years after smoking with men. I think that's the one thing that you could conclude, because you all know, make a long story short, the answer to the question, what causes lung cancer? That's an easy one. You know, that's cigarettes. Okay. We saw the men one already. We saw the women one. Here's an interesting thing, too, and you could interpret this any way you want. Here's cancer rates in people younger than 85 years, and here's cancer rates in people older than 85. But the thing I want to point out here is that it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out, in a nutshell, in a big summary, people die of two things, I mean, besides old age. They die of cancer and they die of heart disease. Okay, those are the two reasons why people die. And look back at all your grandmas and grandpas and great-grandmas and maybe mothers and fathers and people, you know, that died of so-called natural causes. They either died of heart disease or cancer. So, relatively speaking, an improvement of one would be something that would be not in the other, because you have to die of one of the two. So, here's somebody that's younger than 85, cancer rates have gone down. Heart disease has gone down. 85, it's gone down, but not quite so much. And in cancer, they stayed about the same for both age groups. On a massive scale, if we cured cancer tomorrow, everybody would die of heart disease, right? If we cured heart disease tomorrow, everybody would die of cancer. I guess that's one way of looking at it. So you have to take these all into consideration relatively as well. Let's get into some of the so-called environmental factors. We're going to go extremely in-depth about genes and genetics. So the flip side of genes and genetics is environment, you know, nature versus nurture. And we all know that sun exposure has a big factor, especially with skin cancer. People that live in areas where there's no sun, like Iceland, you know, don't get too many types of skin cancer, especially melanomas. All of the skin cancers are related to sun exposure. So New Zealand, where there's a lot of sun, has 6 times as many melanomas as Iceland, where there's no sun. Also remember that another, I guess you could call it a protective factor, is melanin. You know, the more you're protected from the sun, the less likely you are to get melanomas. So blacks have very low incidence relative to whites. And the pigmented parts on white people's skin, like areola, You don't get melanomas on the areola. If you know somebody that had a malignant melanoma of the areola, let me know. I'll give you a Nobel Prize. I've never seen one before in my life. We all know that other environmental exposures, which we'll go into in great detail in Chapter 9, smoking and alcohol, smoking and alcohol, smoking and alcohol. And also, food. Obesity has a high relationship to cancer, especially in the cancers of number one sex incidence. So obese men are a lot more likely to get prostate cancer. Obese women are a lot more likely to get breast cancer. There's also racial, environmental so-called factors. So the cancers that were very, very rare in Asia, or let's say Japan, they get less rare as the generations go on if these immigrants move to the United States. So, you know, let's make this very, very simple. You know, let's say the Japanese originally, years ago, before they were poisoned by Western diets, they didn't get heart disease, they didn't get atherosclerosis, they got stomach cancer all the time. And now the Japanese immigrants that move here and are exposed to our diet, and especially their children now exposed to the diet even more, are more in jive with the regular old USA statistics. And of course, viral exposures. You know, we know very clearly that there's a handful of well-documented human viruses that cause cancer. We know that HPV causes cervical cancer. So are you thinking, well, maybe cervical cancer is really an infectious disease rather than a cancer? Yeah, you could look at it that way. And it's really one of the number one cancers in the world now that is being attacked globally because of its tremendous incidence in young women. You know, now that we're giving HPV vaccines to prevent HPV, will that cancer incidence be going down in the future? Well, that's the general idea. Hepatitis B virus, you know, worldwide, especially Asia and Africa. Not only is it, you know, the biggest kind of hepatitis there, but it's the biggest cause of liver cancer. Most of the people have hepatomas, you know, the malignancies of liver, hepatocellular carcinoma in the Africa and Asia, have it in a background of hepatitis B, going to a stage of cirrhosis and then going into a stage of liver cancer. I attended a big international liver conference in Hong Kong last month, and that's exactly the story. Of course, in the other side of the planet, the Western Hemisphere, it's hepatitis C that has the biggest association with liver cancer. On the other side of the globe, it's hepatitis B. And of course, we've known for a long time that the EB virus, you know, that same virus causes mono. Epstein-Barr virus is very, very big in causing malignant lymphomas, especially the type of lymphoma we'll be showing you called Burkitt's lymphoma. Here's another interesting statistic that we talked about. And let's say we have Japan originally, way back when, showing a very high incidence of stomach cancer and a very low incidence of prostate cancer. Well, when these Japanese moved to California, their incidence of stomach cancer went down, just like the United States statistics here on the bottom, and their incidence of prostate cancer came up. And their children, it came down even more for stomach cancer, and it came up even higher to the same incidence now as California, you know, white males. So eventually you could see clearly that at least with prostate cancer, you gotta know that environment, diet is a huge, huge, huge factor. Okay, and in general, we all know that older people get cancer. And I think the best explanation for that is that they've just been around longer and there's more time for all of these causes we're going to talk about to be doing their dirty deeds. We know that childhood cancers are basically leukemias and hematologic malignancies like lymphomas. Many, many bone tumors are fairly specific for kids, and brain tumors, primary brain tumors, are very, very common in kids as well. But all the other cancers are generally in older people. And the longer you live, the longer you're likely to get a malignancy. That goes without saying, isn't it? There are familial cancer syndromes. In the familial cancers, due to the genetics of it, the people that get the tumors are generally less likely to be less than 55 years old. They have an early age of onset. And if they have primary relatives, of course, the closer they are related to these people, if they get cancers, then they're more likely to get it too. And that once again goes to the what we call the multigenic or the soil theory, is that the soils in which cancers or diseases in general arise would be similar to other soils, and other soils are close relatives. And that's also true with multiple or bilateral tumors. And the best example of that would be tumors of the lower urinary tract. When you have a tumor arising from the ureter, bladder, renal pelvis, think of that epithelium as being a soil. And if a cancer develops in that soil, it means that even if you take the cancer out, that soil is still there. So when you get cancers of certain areas, and lower urinary tract is also always the one that's used, there's very, very frequently another tumor somewhere in that soil. And the soil happens to be what we call transitional epithelium or urothelium. And of course, also related to that directly is the fact that procarcinogens are things that are metabolized by genes to become carcinogens, like nitrites is always the best example. And the way you metabolize certain carcinogens or procarcinogens, especially that become carcinogens, depends on your genes. And these are all genetically factors of cancer. Another thing to deal with is a topic that has a lot of misunderstanding, and that's the so-called other non-malignant diseases which predispose to cancer. And they are generally all lumped into this concept of hyperplasia. Okay, so very often in the cervix, for example, you'll see a pap smear, and it'll be reported chronic inflammation, inflammation, inflammation. Maybe at some point in time, there'll be some atypia or premalignant or dysplastic changes, you know, CIN, SIL, whatever you want to call it, in situ carcinoma. And so you ask yourself, does the chronic inflammation precede or cause the dysplasia? And the answer is no. Now, many chronic inflammatory diseases, however, like chronic ulcerative colitis is a good example, atrophic gastritis is a good example, leukoplakia is another good example. In these diseases, you have a normal increased turnover of cells. And even though hyperplasia in itself is not precancerous, hyperplasia is a factor in carcinogenesis. You need two things to cause cancer. Number one, you need a carcinogen. And then number two, you need a factor which is a hyperplastic factor. It's the concept of initiators and promoters. We'll get into that as well. But remember, hyperplasia in itself is not dysplasia. It's not neoplasia. It's just hyperplasia. Nevertheless, certain diseases like chronic ulcerative colitis, where there's increased mucosal turnover or in the stomach, or hyperplastic changes in mucous membranes, especially in the upper respiratory tract, the oral cavity, these are often associated with premalignancy. Next one is something we've seen before, and it is absolutely worth talking about again. And I read it before, and I just may read it again. A neoplastic tissue is something that grows uncoordinated with that of normal tissues. So, to understand what causes cancer, you have to understand all of the genetic factors which regulate growth. So that goes back to our original definition again, doesn't it? We said that what causes cancer are mutations of cells that regulate growth. And there's a whole ton of genes that regulate growth. So when these genes are mutated, they no longer regulate growth. It's not a simple definition because there's a lot of genes, and it's a multi-step process. It's not one mutation and bingo, you have a cancer cell. You also have this whole big thing called immune surveillance, which is on the other side of the equation. And probably many, if not most, of cancer cells, or almost cancer cells, or dysplastic cells, are killed before they ever get a chance to do damage. So let's go into some of the things now. I put this one here first because it's a good summary of the cell cycle, but we may come back to it again, or maybe we should go to this particular picture first. We're going to talk about oncogenes. What are oncogenes? Well, we know what genes are, and so oncogenes must be mutations of normal genes that are involved in carcinogens. So if a normal gene is a proto-oncogene, then a mutation of a normal proto-oncogene would be an oncogene. And it's only after that mutation occurs that we have factors that are being involved in carcinogenesis. Think about it. Remember we went through a whole bunch of growth factors? Well, cancer is growth, isn't it? Let's say that you had an overabundance of growth factors due to mutations of normal genes. Well, would that be a big factor in carcinogenesis? Absolutely. What about growth factor receptors? Remember, every growth factor has to have not only an origin, but a cell or cells that it acts on. Let's say that those cells have increase or overexpression of their receptors because of mutations of normal genes. Would that be a factor in cancer? Absolutely. These are like the biggest factors. There is something called signal transduction, which I hope is not a new term to you. It's a generic term. A signal transduction is a general term that refers to any process by which one cell converts a kind of signal into another. Well, mutations of signal transduction proteins, or the genes that make them, so-called RAS proteins, are very, very important in carcinogenesis itself. And the RAS mutation, the RAS proteins, are found in, probably the majority, many, many, many different types of human cancers. What about nuclear regulatory proteins? You'd think that's something that regulates growth and DNA, of course, which is nuclear. You think that a mutation of those normal genes or proto-oncogenes would be a big factor in carcinogenesis? Absolutely. And we'll go back, we'll start out with the last one now because it's really a good review. What about cell cycle regulators? Let's say that you have a variety of enzymes called kinases which regulate proteins which determine the cell cycle phases. Let's say that you have mutations of those genes and the cell cycle is not regulated, or there are genes which suppress those kinases. You think that would be a factor in carcinogenesis? And of course the answer is yes. And remember, you'll also hear the term oncoprotein sometimes. And if you could say that a normal gene, which is a proto-oncogene, codes for a normal protein, I think you could say that an oncogene codes for an oncoprotein. That's an easy way to remember that depth. So let's go to the cell cycle to start out with. Do you remember we talked about G1 phase, which is pre-synthetic or pre-DNA synthesis? And then we talked about G2, which is also pre-mitotic, so it's called pre-mitotic. Remember we had those cycles? Well, there are proteins called cyclins which help transition those different phases of the cell cycle. And if you go from G1 to S, the big one is cyclin D. And if you go from S to G2, the big one is cyclin A, and so on. And if you just wanted to look at these transitions, you remember it goes in the order of, just as you go from G1 to S to G2 to M, you got your cyclins D, E, A, and B, respectively. Now, each one of those cyclins is regulated by a phosphorylating enzyme. Remember, those are called kinases, which enable those cyclins to do their job. In this case, it happens to be CDK4 enabling cyclin D, CDK2 enabling cyclin E, CDK2 again enabling cyclin A, and then CDK1 enabling cyclin B. Let's say that you had inhibitors to those cyclins. Let's say that you had genes which inhibited them. And one of the class of genes are called the CYPs and the KIPs. Another class of genes are the INC genes and the ARF genes. And if you ask me what do all of these things stand for, I would just have to say, I don't know, there's so many of them. It's so hard to go back and say, well, what exactly do all these letters, these acronyms stands for in a gene? It's better to just learn the name. Just know that INC genes and ARF genes, you know, inhibit the kinases which enable these normal things. So would these inhibiting genes be resolved in possible abnormal growth because you are now messing up the cell cycle? Absolutely yes. And also remember, probably the single biggest tumor suppressor gene is P53. Now I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, well, if P53 inhibits tumors, shouldn't that be a good gene? Well, it is. But what about if this gene was mutated? Mutations of P53 are then going to result in growth not being suppressed. So that's cancer, isn't it? So once again, you almost have to think backwards when you think about the etiology of cancer. Classically, most students and most adults and most doctors, they think that something mysterious happens inside the nucleus of that cell and bingo, it goes into a cancer cell. Well, it's not quite that easy. You have to think about all of the genetic factors that control the growth of that cell. And it's the loss of those controlling factors that causes cancer. And we just defined the cause of cancer again, didn't we? So here, do you remember we talked about growth factors, growth factor receptors, signal transduction proteins, nuclear regulatory proteins? Now we're going to go into a list of them. And I don't know, there's a pretty long list here. I don't know if I would, you know, ask you to memorize all this stuff, mostly because I never memorized it myself. But I think you should get the principle. In every case now, in the next few slides that I show you, you're going to have a growth factor, okay? And a proto-oncogene is a normal gene. But let's say the proto-oncogenes are mutated, okay, and they become oncogenes. Well, in every case, then something different is going to happen. So in the case of PDGF beta chain, the cis normal proto-oncogene is then overexpressed. And that's going to give rise to certain tumors. And even though they put astrocytoma at the top of the list and osteosarcoma on the top of the list, it's very likely that in each one of these mutations you're going to see a variety. And that these tumors may increase as time goes on as well. And you might say, well, what do astrocytes have in common with osteocytes? And you think, well, probably nothing. But very often this list, very likely this list is going to expand. Do you remember not only platelet-derived growth factor, but what about fibroblast growth factor? Well, the gene which regulates that are normal genes, HST1, INT2, the fibroblast growth factors. What if they are mutated? And in that one case, they're either overexpressed or amplified. Now, for all practical purposes, let's say that these are the same, even though they differentiate between overexpression of a gene and amplification. The end result is that because of increased activity, whether it's overexpression or amplification, you're going to wind up getting cancers. And in one case, it's a very well known. These are all well known experimentally. Stomach cancer is definitely caused when there's an overexpression of fibroblast growth factor due to a mutation in the proto-oncogene HST1. The principle is the same for all of these. What about TGF-alpha? Remember that one? Well, let's say that you have a mutation of the proto-oncogene that produces that growth factor, and the result is that it's overexpressed. Here we go again, some more brain tumors, astrocytoma. Also, it's a big, big factor in hepatocellular carcinomas. So I know I told you 2 minutes ago that hepatocellular carcinoma was caused by hepatitis B virus in the east and hepatitis C virus in the west. And now I'm trying to tell you that's caused due to a genetic mutation of TGF-alpha resulting in overexpression of that gene. So you see what I mean? It's not quite simple. You can never put A and say A causes B. You know that there has to be a relationship between the virus and the genetic mutation, don't you? What about human growth factor? Well, the gene that normally controls that, HGF, is now mutated to become overexpressed. And one of the proven cancers that is caused by it is thyroid cancer. Okay? Let's go on to another group. Before we talked about growth factors, but what about growth factor receptors now? Remember, in a growth factor, you need both a protein made by a gene to act on a cell. Well, the cell that it acts on have to have receptors. And look, let's say that there is a gene which normally controls those receptors, like in the case of the EGF receptor. Okay, you have normal genes called ERBB1, also ECFR, ERBB2. Let's say those are mutated. The principle is the same for every one of these. You have a normal gene that's mutated. The result is either overexpression or amplifications. And now you have increased activity or increased numbers on those cells for the receptors. As a result, they're going to proliferate, and they're going to maybe proliferate abnormally. So these are associated with human tumors, squamous cell carcinoma of lung, gliomas, all because of overexpression of epithelial growth factor receptors. Same thing for leukemias. Let's say that there is a CSF1 receptor on a cell that's controlled by the normal gene FMS. That gene is mutated. As a result, you now have a factor which causes proliferation of white blood cells. And you could go all the way down the line here. You know, I don't expect you to remember all these exactly, but I expect you to absolutely understand the principle. In every case, once again, we have normal proto-oncogenes. They're mutated to become oncogenes. The oncogene may be called exactly the same as the proto-oncogene. As a result, things are going to happen in that cell that cause it to proliferate. In this case, in the previous case, we saw that it was the growth factors. In this case, we saw it was growth factor receptors. And now, let's talk about this concept, this very fuzzy concept of signal transduction proteins, okay? And the biggest class of signal transduction proteins are your RAS proteins. I don't know what it stands for, but I think it was discovered in a rat, so I think that's what the R stands for. But now you have various normal genes called the RAS genes, and there's a K, and there's a H, and there's a N, and there's other ones. Now they're mutated, okay? These proto-oncogenes are mutated, and they wind up giving rise to, the list is just too large to remember. I think that RAS mutations are present in probably, if not half, maybe even the majority of human malignancies. Other things may be going on as well. And remember, there are also other signal transduction proteins like tyrosine kinase, but most of them are related to RAS. So when you think of signal transduction protein, think of the one that's been studied the most. Those are your RAS genes, your RAS proteins. They're mutated, and they give rise to a whole wide variety of human malignancies. We got another list, and it shows exactly the same thing. Remember, transcription activators, the nuclear regulatory proteins? These are generally in the category of your MYC oncogenes and proto-oncogenes. The MYC proto-oncogene, the various types, the MYC proto-oncogenes, they're mutated. Maybe in one case there might be mutated because of a translocation or an amplification, and they wind up ultimately giving rise to malignancies. Now, I told you a few minutes ago that the Epstein-Barr virus causes Burkitt's lymphoma, and now I'm telling you that translocation resulting in a mutation of CNYC is the cause. You see, it's never ever really one thing. And of course, the so-called neural endocrine type of carcinomas, like small cell carcinoma of the lung or neuroblastomas, small cell carcinoma, they're also very, very highly linked to MYC mutations as well. And let's go into it a little bit more. That's a big one. We know that the MYC is very important in a transcription. Remember the conversion of DNA to messenger RNA, but it's also important with apoptosis as well. So if and I'm thinking wrong now, I'm thinking board exam rather than real knowledge, but you should remember that some of these genes act at various levels, especially the ones that have been studied the most, and especially some of the others I'm going to be showing you. So the MYG gene, MYC gene, not only does it code for a protein that binds DNA to other genes, but it's also important with apoptosis. So a mutation of the MYC gene might result in apoptosis not happening. And if you have a cell that should be going apoptosis and it doesn't, then it's an abnormal cell that's proliferating, isn't it? And let's go into the two biggest genes now today involved with human malignancies. We're going to talk about P53 mutations, RAS mutations. These are the big ones. P53 mutations are involved in more than half of all human cancers. No matter what you hear causes a cancer, you can assume it's more likely than not that there's going to be a mutation of a P53 gene. And also RAS. In RAS, I think the statistics are a little bit less. I think it's maybe one-third rather than one-half. And RAS is still described as the single most common abnormality of dominant oncogenes in human tumors. And we saw that there's a whole bunch of them. But remember, for the biggies, which have been studied the most, and P53 has probably been studied more than anything, it acts on more than one level. You know, P53 activates DNA repair proteins. It acts as a transition sentinel between the G1 and the synthetic phase, or from the pre-synthetic to the synthetic phase of the cell cycle. It also initiates apoptosis as well, just like MYC does, doesn't it? So if you have a mutation of a gene that normally initiates apoptosis, and you screw up that gene, guess what? It might not be able to initiate apoptosis. And what does that mean? It means an abnormal cell, perhaps a cancer cell, or a precancer cell, if you prefer the word, which normally would or should die due to this normal pre-programmed apoptosis, it doesn't die, so it proliferates. And in fact, if you know somebody that has cancer, more likely than not, they have some type of mutation of the P53 gene. I'm just going to show you something as an example. This is a RAS protein resulting from a RAS mutation, and it's just like a regular protein. You know, it has these coils and secondary and tertiary things. And in this case, it just happens to be a protein resulting from a RAS gene. Okay, now let's get into some more specific things. And whereas I told you a few minutes ago that you don't have to memorize all of those growth factors and growth factor receptors and blah, 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 these are some things that you should probably know. And very likely they always have some kind of reference to so-called tumor suppressor genes on exams. But don't think in terms of exams. Just think of in terms of mutations of genes resulting in rather specific human neoplasms. And what I'm going to do is, because we're near the hour, what I'm going to do is I'm going to just mention them quickly, and then I'm going to go into the principles and general mechanisms. You should know. You should generally know when you see a list, when you see TGF-beta or E-cadherin or P53 or RB, you should know that a lot of times these genes are really talking about the tissues that they cause cancer in. So you think that BRCA might mean breast cancer, or you think that WT might mean Wilms tumors. You think NF might result in neural fibromas. Generally speaking, sometimes you could tell, but in every case, we have a mutation of a growth suppressor gene resulting in the lack of that gene's ability to suppress growth. And then what happens? Well, this is what happens, all these kinds of different tumors. Okay, you know, we're going to take our little break now. And remember, we're not going to have a lab today, and we didn't have a lab yesterday, which means we're going to have two big, big, big labs next week. So I think we're ready to hear some nice interim music, and I'm just going to pop open the window because of my insecurity and ask you again, was everybody able to hear me pretty well in the first hour? And I'm seeing a whole bunch of yeses. And here, I got a really good question for you. It's about scorpions. I used to catch scorpions as a hobby, and I want to ask you a question. If you were out in the desert, you know, like Death Valley or Nevada or Morocco or wherever your deserts are, and you were to catch a whole bunch of scorpions, and you were going to put them in a jar and take them home to impress your kids, and probably you looked in that jar 5 minutes later, and there would only be one left that's living. So here's the question. Would that living scorpion be your biggest one or your smallest one? Yeah, the smallest one, you're right. Because the smaller you are, the more venomous venom that you need. Okay, I don't know if we could make a conclusion about that in life, but let's hear some music. I'll do my usual things, and I'll see you back here in 10 minutes.
Is this the real life? Is this just fantasy? Caught in a landslide, no escape from reality. Open your eyes, look up to the skies and see. Easy go, little high, little low. Any way the wind blows doesn't really matter to me. Mama just killed a man, put a gun against me. Trigger, now he's dead. Mama, life had just begun, but now I've gone and thrown it all away. Mama, didn't mean to make you cry. If I'm not back again,
let me go. Beelzebub has the devil put a sack on me.
First rock and roll songs ever.
You shake my nerves and you rattle my brain. Too much love drives a man insane. You broke my will, but what a thrill. Goodness is gracious, great balls of fire. I let you love all the boys of mine. You came along and woo, now honey. I changed my mind, the struggle's fine. Great balls of fire. Kisses the baby. Feels good. Hold me, baby. Well, I want to love you like I love the sugar. You're fine. So kind. Got to tell this world that you're mine. I choose my nails out and that went on my thumb. I'm real nervous, but it sure is fun. Come on, baby. It drives me crazy. Real nice, but it sure is fun. Come on, baby. Run the trail.
We're back, and we had a nice break, and as always, whenever I'm on break and I let the doggy out, I always get like a little inspirational thought to ask you, usually in form of a survey. So we're going to do a couple little survey questions before we start in with the second and last part of Chapter 7 on Neoplasm. This question I'm going to ask you, it doesn't matter what you answer. If you answer no, that's fine. I'm not here to be a hall monitor. I don't do that kind of crap. I don't give exams. I don't flunk anybody. I don't give grades. You know, I don't give a damn even if you show up or not. And if you're out there, you know, laughing at me because you think I'm stupid, that's okay too. But here's the question. I just have to know if there's anybody out there that has already read the chapter in Robbins. I don't care if it's 7th or 8th edition, on neoplasms. Okay, I see at least one person did it. That's all I need was one person. Probably most of you say no, that's fine. There's a couple that have said yes. Now, for the two people that have said yes, or three people, I just want to ask you one question. And I know who you are because I see your names. For the three people that said yes, let me just ask you a question. Please, it's very important. Did you understand it? This is only directed to the three people that said yes. Okay, one of them said yes, but the other one said not much, and the other one said partly. Okay, well, I made my point. What I'm trying to say is I try to read it too. I didn't really understand it fully either. It is jam-packed with intense, difficult genetic concepts and things and acronyms. I don't think it's fair to expect the average old regular medical student to remember all that stuff. So my job is to try to understand it as much as I can and then summarize it. And that's what I'm very, very proud that I do. But you want to know something? There's always going to be some person on the board that'll want you to remember there was a little arrow between two enzymes, you know, in page, you know, 872. And like, I can't do anything about that. The most important thing is, even though we say that this course is for passing the test well, it's really to understand pathology, and that's what my job is. Now, here's part two. Here's the second thought that I got. I really like that movie that you partly saw and listened to the music to beautifully, and Stand By Me, played all around the world. I want to take that song, and I'm going to do a little video editing, and I want to put all of my students' pictures in there somewhere along the line. So I've got, when this first part of pathology is over, pathology one, I usually grant certificates to the people that have been to class a lot, and they say, oh, Dr. Minarsik, I've been to most of your classes, and if I didn't go to all of them, I saw a bunch of your movies. Well, if you say that and you send me a picture of yourself and where you're from, then I'm going to take that movie and I'm going to put your pictures in there, because I would like to think that I'm making music around the world as well. That's been one of my dreams, is to have like a real global music thing showing all of my students all over the world. Okay, we'll deal with that later because we're still three chapters away. What we have to do now is actually deal with the last part of this chapter. We did the really horrible, grisly stuff today. The rest of it will be fun, and it'll be nice and clinical again. So we're going to finish up in our second session with this one long chapter, and then we're going to do two sessions of labs. Okay, here's the drill. Here's the principle. In every case, again, we have genes, and they usually go by acronyms, some of which you can understand. We've already talked about the ink ones for being the controllers of the cell cycle. We talked about some of them are named by the tumor that it produces, like WT producing Wilms tumor. We already said P53 does everything. We're saying that the RB, what a gene might be called retinoblastoma if it's mutated. We didn't talk about the SMADs yet, but we're going to go into that somewhere along the line again. We talked about the cadherins, and if you think adhere means to join together, then a mutation of a gene which joins cells together might make them loose and separate and migrate and be a factor in causing cancer. We said that the TGF, the growth factor beta, is also indicted in many colon cancers. We said NF neurofibroma. Now, in every case of here, these are called tumor suppressor genes. Now, that's not really a good name, because really, if there was a gene that suppressed tumors, you would think, boy, that must be a great gene. But it's really, these are really growth suppression, growth controlling genes. So mutations of them would result in these genes not controlling growth. And as a result, even though there's one little arrow there, there's probably 8,000 arrows if you look at the biochemistry books, it will result in these malignancies. So that's the good news. The bad news is, if you just should sort of rotely remember that if you see KLF gene being mutated, think prostate. That one's easy because they do it clinically now. You know, genetic tests for mutations of the BRCA gene. We talked about the INC ones, GI and breast, WT gene mutation, Wilms tumor, P53 mutation, just about everything, RB mutation, retinoblastoma, SMADs we'll get into, resulting in a lot of the GI cancers. The cadherin mutations, we got stomach, we got GI, even melanoma. So that's the general drill, that's the general principle. So you could just remember in these little yellow font here, these are mutations of growth suppressor genes ultimately resulting in cancers. Here's another thing to remember as well, and we're not going to go into them. I don't know how much Robbins went into them, but another factor to remember in malignancy development is that very often if a gene becomes mutated and therefore the cell becomes ineffective or abnormal or even potentially cancerous, there is this normal mechanism we have in our body called apoptosis. So if there are certain genes which, when mutated, we've already mentioned Mike, we've already mentioned P53, there's another one called BCL. Put these three genes in your pocket to remember when they're mutated, they're going to result in cells evading apoptosis. And if a cell doesn't apop when it's supposed to, then it's going to proliferate, and that proliferation might wind up ultimately being a malignancy. It's also important to remember, I mean, you throw five or six little diseases or cancers at you again, that one of the factors in carcinogenesis is mutations in DNA repair genes. You know, DNA repair is a process that's like a spell checker. So when I show you these PowerPoints, I see a little typo often. You can see me go back and fix them, put in a period or add a T rather than an H or something. Well, you know, there are enzymes that do that with DNA too. And those enzymes are determined by genes. So a mutation of those genes would result in ultimately abnormal or even malignant conditions. And the best example of that, something that's being done at our own lab at GoPath, is a test, a molecular, a genetic test for the HNPCC gene. And that stands for hereditary non-polyposis colon cancer. And you know, some of the colon cancers arise from polyps, but some of them just arise without a previous polyp. And it can also be a gene that's in the family, a mutation that's in the family. So the HNPCC mutation would result in defective DNA repair. Also remember that there are other genes which are involved in DNA repair fixing normally, like transforming growth factor beta, beta-catenin, the BAX gene. These are all genes which you can remember are involved with DNA repair gene defects. There's another disease, skin diseases. It's not necessarily a malignancy, but it could be associated with tumors, called xeroderma pigmentosum. And that's a gene that is mutated by ultraviolet light, resulting in defective gene, defective DNA repair. Another immune disease called ataxia telangiectasia, and if you think it might result in some cerebellar or muscle coordination defect, as well as dilated blood vessels in various parts of the body, then that ATM gene for ataxia telangiectasia is also a DNA repair gene, and a mutation of it would result in this disease. Also, Bloom syndrome. I put these in there. I don't know much about these diseases. Of course, I never had a patient. You know, we've all heard of Fanconi's anemia, Bloom syndrome. I want you to take these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 diseases, one of which is very, very, very common, and the other ones are relatively exotic. We might refer to them later on in the course. These are all diseases which result in DNA repair gene defects or mutations. Let's talk about the telomeres. You see this little guy up here in the northwest corner? I have the opinion, or I have the option of blowing it up for you. This was probably FISH, the technique we talked about, fluorescence, for detecting a part of the chromosome called the telomere. You see, they're at the ends of the chromosomes. So paired chromosomes have 4 telomeres, one at the end. Each one has it. Well, these little dots, these little telomeres, these little regions at the end of the chromosome, are very, very important in the replicative lives of cells. In other words, a telomere determines the number of times a cell can divide, like a cat with 9 lives. You know, after the cat runs out of 9 lives, it's really dead. You could also think of it as like when you go to your student union and you see that somebody wants to rent their apartment, so they put these little matches like things and you rip one off. Well, after all those are ripped off, it's dead, you know. So there, a telomere determines the exact number of times. Now, let's say that you have a enzyme called telomerase, and let's say it's present abnormally, and so as a result your telomeres are messed with, they're defective. You now have unlimited replicative potential, rather than a cell that's only supposed to divide 7 times and then it goes to apoptosis. Well, let's say that your telomeres are messed with because of telomerase, which may also be present. And in fact, it's present in over 90% of human cancers. And that also explains a reason why certain cells have unlimited replicative potential. But let's talk about something that's even practically much more important, and that's tumor angiogenesis. Now think about it. Most of the tumors that kill people are big. We've said that it's about 1 kilogram of tumor that normally kills a person, and that's only if you're thinking anatomically. If you're thinking physiologically, it could be a hell of a lot less, and its location is also extremely important too, and how much of the organ or tissue whose function it interferes with. Well, the question is, how close does a blood vessel have to be to a cell for that cell to live, especially if it's a cancer cell? And the answer is only about 1 or 2 millimeters, and that's a pretty good sized distance. So tumors can't kill you unless they evoke angiogenesis. And remember, we talked about vascular endothelial growth factor and fibroblast growth factor B as being two of the biggest, most powerful growth factors to evoke angiogenesis, even in normal processes. Well, guess what? Some tumors can evoke it too, because if you didn't have extra blood vessels, that tumor couldn't grow more than about 1 or 2 millimeters big, could it? And in general, when we look at a lot of tumors in the lab, including the tumors we've looked at already, you'll notice that they very often are hypervascular. And even to a radiologist who's injecting a dye, he may see a tumor in the kidney, and during the injection phase, he can see it's taking up a lot more blood than the rest of the kidney. So generally, tumors evoke the growth of new blood vessels. And if you think of it as sort of like a hemostasis process, is that you have a tumor, and if it is all the factors which are causing angiogenesis would tend to make that tumor become bigger. And if you have all of the factors which control angiogenesis or anti-angiogenesis, that would tend to regulate or limit the size of the tumor. So a lot of the cancer therapies, of course, both anatomically as well as drug-related, are trying to push the anti-angiogenesis part of that homeostatic mechanism. Now, here's the best picture of all, and it's from robins, and I think this is the best picture in the world to understand tumor mechanisms. Now that we talked about causes, let's talk about what they're doing. Well, remember we said you have normal, in this case we're talking about cancer. We're talking about carcinoma. We're talking about epithelial malignancies. We talked about dysplastic changes. And then we'll go into factors which make those cells loose, not adhere to each other. But then what they do start to adhere to is the basement membrane. And then they have movements, they have amoeba-like motility, which not only breaches that basement membrane, but causes this thing called infiltration. And then a certain fraction of those cells, which we've seen in a previous diagram, are then theoretically capable of metastasizing. In order to metastasize, those invaded cells have to breach another membrane called a blood vessel, of which endothelium is the final step, and go into the blood, or intravasation. They may then react with host lymphocytes, being cells which shouldn't normally be in there. They may form also some degree of reactions, platelet adherence, coagulation perhaps, but then they have to do the opposite. They have to extravasate in order to metastasize. And think of it, every one of these is a very, very intricate step. And it's almost like fertilization or evolution in general. And perhaps it's maybe only 1 in a million or 1 in a billion of these original cancer cells which wind up ultimately extravasating, perhaps even after several more mitotic divisions, and establishing itself in another area. And that's metastasis. So, do you remember when we talked about this linear process in inflammation? Well, this is also a very, very linear process. You cannot put these out of order. If I was to give you an exam, I would take these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, I would take these 9 things, and I would say you have to arrange them in the proper order. And even if one is out of order, you're wrong. So you have to have your malignant transformation, whatever that is, your carcinogen, your promoter, your initiator. There has to be growth. There has to be bone marrow invasion or infiltration, if you rather use that word. There then has to be angiogenesis to make that group of cells bigger. You then have to have breaking away from your invasive clone into the blood vessel. You then travel downstream. If you're in a vein, you're going towards the heart. If you're in a lymphatic, you're going towards the lymph node. If you're in an artery, which is less likely, you're going away from the heart. You then have to have adhesion to the blood vessel wall and extravasation. And then finally, you have your metastatic growth. And remember, just about any malignant tumor has a capacity to metastasize. So when you think about like all of these steps in the equation, you would think, well, you know, if there's only one that we could develop a drug for, and we could have that malignancy not metastasize, then you could probably cure the patient or save the patient, or at least perhaps give them a lifespan which approaches their normal statistical expected lifespan. And this is, of course, the role of chemotherapy. And when I took my wife to the chemotherapist many times, I had a lot of discussion with a medical oncologist. Basically, he says, we're basically trying to make cancer, like AIDS, a chronic manageable disease. Okay, now let's talk about the early part of this process, right when we're right here, and you go from normal to dysplastic carcinoma in situ to invasion. Let's take that first part of it. Think about it. You have so-called malignant cells, and they have to loosen up with respect to each other. They have to lose their adherence. They have to be more independent, slippery from each other. And we knew that many, many, many years ago. Even before I was born, all the old pathologists are saying cancer cells are slipperier than regular cells. And it's only now that we know why, because of all of the adhering proteins which are involved. You then have to have attachment of those malignant cells to your matrix, okay? And then you have to destroy that basement membrane by perhaps activating collagenase, because remember, the basement membrane is type 4 collagen. And then you have to have migration of those tumor cells from one side of the basement membrane that's been destroyed to the other. And here's a nice diagram of it. I believe this is from Robbins too. Here you have your type 4 collagen nicely on one side of the epithelial cells. You've already had some problem with your cadherins loosening up, the things that make cells adhere to one another. You now have cells which are slipperier, looser. But just as they have become slipperier from respect to each other, they now have more attachment to the basement membrane. Okay? Here you have one that has a laminin receptor. Here you have one that has a fibronectin receptor. Okay? So just as they loosen up with respect to each other, they're now adhering more to the ECM towards the basement membrane. And guess what? We are now releasing collagenase, and that collagenase is now destroying the collagen, the type 4 collagen of the basement membrane. And look what happens when that collagen is digested. It's breached. These cells now have a motility function. Not only is that wall broken, but in addition to that, you have motility factors within the cancer cells themselves. Let's look at the other end of the process, metastases. And I want you to remember, and we're not going to go into this because nobody really knows a hell of a lot about it, that if you hear of the KIS gene, the KA1 gene, or the NM23 genes, these are genes which are also involved with metastasis in a variety of human tumors. And just like we told you to think of cancer not as being some mutation which causes the cell to become malignant, we told you to think of mutations in the controlling factors of those cells. Well, the same thing is true with metastasis as well. There's nothing that happens inside of a cell which says, boy, I'm supercharged, I can metastasize. No, what happens is that the genes which keep those cells in one place, in other words, those metastatic suppressor genes, which these are now mutated. So once again, Metastasis, just like carcinogenesis, is loss of regulation, isn't it? It's the same damn process. You have to think on a separate level rather than just think, oh, well, there's a gene there that's causing it to be bad. No, the controlling factors are being mutated. What about chromosomal changes in cancer? We talked about genes, you know, let's go up at the DNA a little bit. Let's talk about segments of chromosomes. Well, you know, or we've mentioned this before, maybe you don't know or you don't remember, that in many or if most of malignant lymphomas, there is often a very predictable chromosome change. And usually they're translocations in which one part of one chromosome attaches to another part. They kind of switch each other up. But another one is an inversion. There could be a part of a chromosome that simply inverts itself. In this case, it happens to be in the long arm or the Q arm. And in this case, we could see that in both long arms, you're more likely to have a translocation in a long arm because there's more chromosome there, okay? We have a switching of a chromosome that has a shorter long arm with another chromosome that has a longer long arm, so you wind up having something like this. That's very predictable in most of the hematologic malignancies, in other words, the leukemias, the lymphomas. But also, there's a growing number of non-hematologic malignancies which we're seeing translocations and inversions also. And I don't want you to memorize this. I mean, if you're good, if you can, you know, you're a genius. But just remember that in CML, these are almost all hematologic malignancies, a leukemia, acute leukemias, both myelocytic as well as lymphocytic. Burkitt's lymphoma again. Now we got a third cause for Burkitt's lymphoma. Not just a genetic change, not just a virus, but now we have a often predictable translocation. Different types of lymphomas, non-Hodgkin's lymphomas like a mantle cell lymphoma, follicular lymphoma, a lymphoma that also has a leukemic phase. So all of the lymphocytic leukemias are now classified with the lymphomas. And Ewing's sarcoma, another type of malignancy of lymphoid-like tissue. These are all translocations. And if you could see, if you see a Q here, which most of them are, you probably will see a P somewhere along the line. No, look, they're all Qs, aren't they? So it's almost always the longer arms because there's more stuff to the more likely to translocate. And they actually tell you the location. Okay, this is a symbols for translocations. And when those translocations occur, by the way, they're also going to affect certain genes as well. And remember we talked about the BCR gene, remember we talked about cyclin inhibitors, remember we talked about the MYC genes. So I think if you tried to memorize this, you'd probably go crazy, and I never did either, so... By this stage of our journey today, which has taken almost 2 hours now, hour and a half, we realize that there's not one single little step that causes cancer. And that's become very apparent. And that's why we couldn't just tell you at the beginning, in 25 words or less, what causes cancer. There's no single oncogene which causes cancer. And remember, it's also a multi-step process. So one way to think of that multiple step process is to think in terms of gatekeepers and caretakers. These are not my words. These are words I think out of Robbins and other people have used them. So if you think of certain genes as being gatekeepers, you know, your proto-oncogenes, which are mutated to become oncogenes, and tumor or growth suppressor genes. Those are the gatekeepers. And if you want to think in terms of DNA repair as being a caretaker, so this guy doesn't let the cancer happen and the caretakers repair things that could cause cancer. That's one way of thinking of it. Another way to remember is that we did not have just one step. Remember we showed you this little diagram here? in which we saw at least 10 or 12 steps. These are all a multi-step process. Okay? So there's this progression going on. Angiogenesis is a big one. Also, tumors, cells, are not all the same. They're all clonal. They're all ultimately from the same, but some are differentiated, some are potentially metastasizable. Some of them have fewer MHC molecules to be recognized by, you know, immune cells. So it's a very, very complex process. And this is an easy one. We're going to be going now into the specific agents which may cause these mutations. It's called carcinogenesis, and we're going to introduce the concept of initiation and promotion. Now, we all know it causes cancer. We've already told you a million things, but in my opinion, the three suspects, the usual suspects, which we've dealt with 10 other times before, you know, radiation, viruses, and chemicals, those are considered carcinogens. But more likely than not, they're considered initiating carcinogens. So there's two things needed to cause cancer. One are the initiators, or things that we think of as the specific carcinogen, like viruses, radiation, chemicals. But then there's also the promotion concept. So after that cancer, after that carcinogen causes the mutation, if it only caused a mutation, you'd probably be okay. But then you need another factor called promotion. And promotion could be likened to just a concept of hyperplasia. So let's go back 20, 30 years, and I'm in medical school, and my professor is saying, you need two things to cause cancer. You need a carcinogen, and then you need something to make that cell keep multiplying. Well, that's the concept of initiator and promoter. The initiators are carcinogens, which cause mutations, and the promoters are all the factors. Some of them are even normal factors, like steroid hormones, which cause the proliferation of the mutated or initiated cells. So there's your carcinogen. It may act directly, or it may be a procarcinogen that has to be metabolized to actually cause DNA mutations. Perhaps that mutation can be repaired. Perhaps it can't be repaired, but it undergoes apoptosis because it's abnormal. And let's say it doesn't, can't be repaired. Well, now you have initiated cell. That's the initiation concept. But now you have to have your promotion, your hyperplastic concept. You have to have things which are causing those cells to proliferate, not just become as well. And some of those concepts are things which would cause any cell to hyperplase. So, here's your initiators, and you know it's the same three guys that cause inflammation, the same three guys that cause birth defects, the same three guys that cause immune suppression, the same three guys that cause cancer, the same three guys that cause mutation. And here they are: chemicals, radiation, and infectious pathogens. These are your three guys that cause cancer, your three initiators. I got a couple of slides here. I'm going to be throwing a lot of stuff at you, even some chemical formulas. I don't remember them myself, but I think you should generally know that there's two types of carcinogens or initiators. There's the kind that act directly by themselves. They don't need any chemical modification. And then there's the procarcinogens, which are metabolized in your body to become more carcinogenic. So I'm just going to throw some of these names at you. And this is going to be kind of like a boring rote part, but you should know that the propiolactones are carcinogens, DMSO, or dimethylene sulfate, carcinogen, diepoxybutane, another one. I even threw their general chemical formula that makes them in this category if you're a big chemistry nut. You should know that anti-cancer drugs, chemotherapy, the cyclophosphamides, especially in the earlier days, chlorambucil, nitrosoureas, these are all cancer-causing drugs. Now, note you're thinking, well, if these are anti-cancer drugs, why should they be causing cancer as well? Well, the rule is that any significant process which is directed to cure or control or to regulate cancer also weakens the immune system and has a potential possibility of causing cancer somewhere down the line. Yeah, it's nice to radiate tumors, but guess what? Radiation was one of our usual suspects, wasn't it? Also, the so-called acylating agents like the imidazoles and the dimethyl carbamyl chloride, these are all things which are used in various industries and so forth. And you should just keep this list in mind. Add to that something that you probably already know, the polycyclic, heterocyclic, aromatic hydrocarbons, the things in tires, the things in azo dyes, the aromatic amines. These are not so much direct, but they're metabolized to become more carcinogenic. And a variety of organic substances as well. We know that aflatoxin has a big role in the development or as an initiator in hepatomas. We know that the antibiotic griseofulvin, an antifungal agent, had a big thing as well. We know that cycasin from cycads. If you don't know what a cycad is, because I didn't know what it was either, that's a cycad. That also has been indicted in human cancers a lot. Good old sassafras. Safrole is carcinogenic. I have a lot of friends from India that chew betel nuts, and boy, it's like tobacco. You know, it's like a nice little stimulant. And these are also highly indicted, linked with oral cancers as well. So I want you to just keep all of these things in mind. Put them in the same list. You don't have to know the mechanisms of each one. But if you look at some of these weird words on here, I want you to remember these are all initiators. Whether you want to call them a direct or a procarcinogen, I don't think it really matters. Here's some more chemicals. We all know that heavy metals, generally many of them are linked with cancer. Chromium and nickel are probably the two biggest ones. You know that the people that worked in factories where there was a lot of vinyl chloride in Kentucky were winding up getting angiosarcomas. So throw vinyl chloride into the category. We know that nitrosamines and amides, tires, nitrates, you know, the stuff they put into Slim Jims, these are all food preservatives, tires from cigarettes, you know, these are also initiators. Insecticides, fungicides, and a big environmental agent, the PCBs. Remember, polychlorinated biphenyls, PCBs, these are also initiators as well. So this list and this list are the guys that cause cancer, okay? Now, let's talk about the promoters. After the cancer is caused, there have to be mechanisms to promote or multiply or hyperplase, if you like that word, the cells. And one of them are just normal hormones. We know that many hormones, especially the steroid hormones, act directly on the nucleus and will result in normal hormonal cellular hyperplastic effect. Another thing is to remember that the formol esters, you remember crotonic acid used in various industries, activates kinase C, and that results in cancer cells being promoted too. Many of the femols, and technically any drug which will normally make a cell proliferate, even if it's not a malignant proliferation, in combination with the initiator will result as the promotion and of cancer. Radiation, well, there's three kinds of skin cancer: basal cells, squamous cells, and melanomas. And guess what? All three of them are related. I am hesitating to use the word cause, but let's say it anyway. Radiation causes cancer. Okay, they're causing the mutations that we were talking about that would result in these malignant proliferations. Ionizing radiation, especially, even if it's non-particulate, you know, even if it's just photons and it doesn't have beta particles or anything like that, the ionizing radiation that we saw that happened in Japan, the effect is usually not immediate, but 90% of the fallout victims within 15 years wound up getting either hematopoietic or thyroid malignancies. As you would guess, ionizing radiation has a much more devastating effect on hematopoietic tissue rather than thyroid tissue. And we're going to see in a future chapter that the single cell in your body, which is the most sensitive to radiation, is a lymphocyte. We all know that there was an increase in solid tumors, not just the leukemias and the lymphomas, with radiation, but they generally have a longer latency period. So if a lot of the leukemias and lymphomas were occurring a few years or maybe a decade or so after the ionizing radiation, I think with the solid tumors that are non-hematologic, non-hematopoietic, non-lymphoid, also remember that therapeutic radiation often has to go through the skin, doesn't it? You don't open up a body and then radiate it. There are ways of focusing the beam, but most radiations of internal structures has to go through the skin, and so you can have like a wide variety of basal cell carcinomas. So if you see a basal cell carcinoma in an area which is normally non-sun exposed, you might ask the patient if they've ever had radiation for another malignancy or another reason. The common viruses cause cancer. We all know that HPV, human papillomavirus, is not only the cause of squamous cell carcinoma of the cervix, but it's a cause of squamous cell proliferations everywhere in the body, both benign and malignant. Keep that in mind. We told you that the Epstein-Barr virus many, many years ago showed a strong link, causal relationship to Burkitt's lymphoma, as well as some of the other mutations we talked about resulting in Burkitt's lymphoma. We all know that the hepatitis B virus, which causes hepatitis B, is a factor, strong factor in hepatoma, because most of the hepatomas, especially in the Orient, on the eastern side of the planet, arise in a background of hepatitis B. Most of the hepatomas in the United States, many of the hepatomas, arise in the background of hepatitis C. Even before we knew exactly what the AIDS virus was, we knew that the first recognized retrovirus, the human T lymphocyte virus 1, was a direct cause in many T-cell malignancies. Of course, when we wound up finding some of these other viruses and we came down to HTLV-3, we then changed the name from HTLV-3 to just regular old HIV, because HIV is HTLV-3. And even though Kaposi's sarcoma, which is the sarcoma associated with many, many AIDS patients, and we all know that HIV causes AIDS, we also know that many AIDS patients have Kaposi's sarcoma, but the Kaposi's sarcoma is caused by another virus in the herpes family. So Kaposi's sarcoma herpes virus is the cause of Kaposi's sarcoma. And Kaposi's sarcoma, AIDS itself is caused by a different virus, isn't it? This kind of stuff can boggle your mind. Here's another big, big, big one. It seems like the people who have looked at H. pylori, you know, the cause of gastric duodenal ulcers, you know, peptic ulcers almost all of the time, also causes gastric lymphomas. You think, well, how could stomach have a lymphoma if it's not a lymphoid organ? Well, remember, there's an awful lot of mucosal associated lymphoid tissue in that submucosa and in the mucosa. Well, when those become malignant, H. pylori is regarded as being a big cause in causing all of those mutations that will enable that malignant lymphoma to occur in the stomach. And guess what? If that wasn't enough, it's also been linked with a lot of gastric mucosal carcinomas as well. The way it's going with H. pylori, I wouldn't be surprised if eventually somebody says it causes all cancers. Now, I'm just being facetious about that, but the stuff that's come out with H. pylori is just mind-boggling. First, we discovered it causes all of the ulcers, so you no longer have to do surgery, you just have to treat the bug. And they said, well, it looks like it's producing the lymphomas in that area, and now they're saying it's causing the carcinomas as well. This is not my opinion. These are the result of many, many, many very good, solid scientific studies. Okay, let's go into the probably the last feature of malignancies. And we talked about what causes it. We talked about what proliferates it. We talked about how they behave. It seems like we've been kind of ignoring the normal body defenses which protect against cancer, the so-called immune surveillance concept. And as you know, when we go back to our basic immunology, we know that the CD8, the effector T cells, act a lot like the NK cells, and they come into direct contact with cells that have the wrong MHC molecules, and they initiate that cell into being ultimately swallowed up by macrophages, or perhaps reacting against it by virtue of non-direct contact such as antibodies. That's just a general scheme of what should go on with cancer cells, and it does in many cases too. So here we have a cell that has normal self proteins, and it's not going to be attacked by the CD8 T cell because it's a friend. Now, the foes are ones that would have abnormal antibodies on them, perhaps due to mutated genes or self-mutated proteins or an overexpressed marker. And in these cases, they're going to be now recognized by these T cells, and the T cells are going to try to destroy them either directly or indirectly. That's the general rule. So, how do the tumor cells escape recognition by the normal immune system, especially the CD8 cells, and go haywire? Well, one thing, just like bacteria, they could mutate so the cell doesn't recognize them. Another thing they could do is to produce a decreased number of MHC molecules on that tumor cell surface so they're not recognized as well. So in one case they're changing, another case they're just not producing enough recognition areas. Another thing to remember is a kind of a difficult concept. I don't know if you've learned about the concept of co-stimulation from another course, but it's not just antigen-antibody recognition between some of these cells. There's also other molecules present, such as CD28 and ICOS, which have been studied extensively. And these are not specific things like antigen antibodies. These are just other molecules that are ultimately needed for one cell to recognize and ultimately set up the mechanism to destroy other cells. Also remember that cancer patients get immunosuppressive therapies, don't they, to decrease sometimes, or they may be immunosuppressed to begin with, which enables that cancer. So anything that weakens the immune system or suppresses it is going to result as tumor not being recognized the way it should. Another thing is that the tumor cells may have the proper antigens on their surfaces to be recognized and ultimately destroyed, but they may have evolved mechanisms or just have mechanisms which result in those antigens not being able to hook up with the CD8 cells or antigen masking. And last but not least, you have to remember some tumor cells can kill the T cells. And you know, even in pathology, sometimes we'll see certain types of tumors cells, malignant cells, swallowing up or phagocytizing, or more likely setting into motion mechanisms that will result in that CDA cell going into apoptosis rather than killing it. These are all not just theories, but a lot of this stuff has been backed up by experimental work as well. Usually when you have a long list of things like this, usually there's one that's much, much more important than the others. We know there's at least five different mechanisms. I suspect that somewhere along the line, somebody's going to say, well, this is the main one here, and that's going to be where most of the focus is going to go on. This is sort of a leading into more of the clinical features now, and I hope this is extremely logical. We know that as a tumor grows, there's anatomic encroachment upon its neighbors. There could be direct infiltration into the neighbors because now the tumor is breaking through membranes and blood vessels and sometimes bones, arteries, you know. Sometimes those tumors are producing hormones or hormone-like substances ectopically, and that's usually the main features of paraneoplastic syndromes. We're going to go into that a little bit. Tumors can bleed if they're rupturing surrounding blood vessels. They can also be a focus for infection if the tissues which they're invading or the tumor itself becomes necrotic. They can cause a wide variety of acute symptoms if there's rupture, infection, infarction of it or its neighbors. And last but not least, the substances what it produces, the metastases, can go back and do all the same things that the primary was doing as well. So it's a pretty grisly situation there, isn't it? Cachexia is one of the big things. You know, normally when you go on a diet, you generally lose more fat than muscle, but the cachexia you get with malignancies, often mediated things like TNF-alpha. You know, the first TNF that was discovered was called cachexin, and now it's called TNF-alpha, because they're finding this to be elevated in patients that were cachectic due to tumors. The interleukins, and I think interleukin 6 is probably the one that's been the most indicted as being overexpressed in patients with general cancers that are losing weight. And remember, when they lose weight, it's not just fat, it's also muscle. There's another interesting thing that is kind of new on the horizon, and that's a substance called proteolysis inducing factor. I tried to get more information on it. There's really not a hell of a lot, but you should probably remember that if somebody was to ask you which things might be overexpressed or elevated in cachectic patients, you could put PIF in the same category with interleukin 6 and TNF-alpha. Okay, paraneoplastic syndromes. In other words, you have a malignancy, but then you wind up having symptoms or changes that are not directly due to the malignancy, perhaps in other parts of the body. We have to talk about the main ones. And the main ones are the endocrine ones, because the general principle for most of the common paraneoplastic syndromes is that the tumor cells are now producing hormone-like substances which are making people look like they have an overabundance of that hormone, but it's really being produced ectopically by the tumor. There are also nerve and muscle conditions like myasthenias with lung cancer. Very often patients with malignancies have hyperpigmentated areas in the folds of their skin, like their armpits and neck, called acanthosis nigricans, also seen with diabetics. Also seen generally muscle problems and skin problems like dermatomyositis. Remember, we talked about that. And that can also be secondary to malignancy. Often patients with clubbing of fingers due to a hypertrophic osteoarthropathy, also called HPOA, hypertrophic pulmonary osteoarthropathy, as seen with lung cancers and other cancers, would be another non-endocrine paraneoplastic syndrome. People with migratory blood clots, thrombophlebitis, even pulmonary emboli are often seen with, at first described in pancreas and other GI type malignancies called Trousseau syndrome. Sometimes patients with endocarditis are secondary to malignancy. Many widespread malignancies result in anemias, and many widespread malignancies result in renal damage, so it can cause a nephrotic syndrome. You know, I just looked at my clock, and I would have liked to have finished this. It's almost over. I guess if I took a vote, some people might say go on, but I really don't like to run over. So let's just say in the next session, which will be next week, we'll finish the few considerations. We'll go into more detail on the endocrine paraneoplastic syndromes. We'll start off here again, and then we'll have a really, really, really big lab next week on Tuesday, and another really, really, really big cancer lab on Thursday. So it'll be all lab next week. And I know that's more fun, but all of the stuff that we presented now in the last two sessions was not with lab. We introduced a lot of concepts, and now we're going to go into the lab and look at these tumors and talk about them and review their clinical and anatomic features again. So I guess we're done. What I'm going to do is just save this thing if I've made any changes. And then I'm going to pop out our little window here, and I'm going to look at the attendance list. Is still really, really nice, so at least I know that me running near the end hasn't scared anybody away. So let's look at that attendance list and see if anybody has their hands up. It would not be fair to not just see if anybody has their hand raised. If nobody does, that's okay too. It means either you feel sorry for me because I've been working so hard, you don't want to bug me anymore, or maybe I explained everything so clearly that you're ready to go and read more and start to kick butt on the USMLE. Yeah, no questions. We're at the end. I'm going to close the PowerPoint. We're going to see my scorpion again. And I always say something about the last inspirational song. This is a recent song. It's by Chris Brown. Believe it or not, this song is one of the all-time biggest videos on YouTube. And not only is it a wonderful, happy, inspirational song, but it has an amazing video. So if you ever want to see something really that'll make you really happy, go to Chris Brown on YouTube and type in "With You." Goodbye, everybody.
I need you, boo. I gotta see you, boo. Yeah, the heart's all over the world tonight. Say the heart's all over the world tonight. I need you, boo.
So glad to be yours. You're a class all your own, and ooh, little beauty, when you talk to me, I swear the whole world's out. You're my sweetheart, and I'm so glad that you're mine. You are one of a kind, and you mean me what I mean to you. And to wherever, baby, there is nothing you won't do. Cause if I got you, no one left, and you like Jordans on Saturday. Forgot I have you and I cannot wait now. Hey, little shorty, say you care for me. You know I care for you. You know that I'll be true. You know that I won't lie. You know that I will try to be your everything. Yeah, I got you. I don't need money. I don't need cars. Girl, you're my all. Yeah.
Buzzards.